Okay, good morning, good evening everyone. Today is May 17th, 2011, Tuesday night, Japan Standard Time. Hello everyone, this is Katz from Yokoso News, yokosonews.com. Yokoso News is the online website to introduce Japan in English so that you can understand Japan more. But... Usually, Yokoso News is like the website to introduce fun stuff about Japan, but since the March 11th earthquake, I've been doing this emergency volunteer kind of the weekly, daily, now weekly show to give you the latest information of what's going on in North Japan, Tohoku area, for the tsunami and earthquake disaster and Fukushima nuclear power plant update thingy, so that you understand, you know. Now Yokoso News was the first English media to report the disaster, and now we are the last one who's still continuously reporting the disaster from Yokkaichi Miya, Japan. Here we go. Today is Tuesday, May 17th, 2011. It's already 2 months passed since the disaster happened, but still, situation at the Fukushima nuclear power plant, it's still critical state. A couple days ago, the TEPCO finally admitted that the meltdown could occur within 16 hours of the earthquake. So meltdown was already happening on the March 12th, a day after for the nuclear reactor 1, 2, 3, and then but it's already happened 2 months ago, so situation is not really changed in terms of the radiation level, so I didn't really mark it as an emergency news, but I will talk about it more about this it's critical, about this update after the today's main show. Today, I have April Perkinson joining us on Skype to talk about, I heard she just came back from Tohoku area, Miyagi, to volunteer. And then our usual guest, Borden from Kazo Saitama, joining us to assist my show, because I don't really speak English well. I'm Japanese. Right, Jim?
No.
Okay.
You speak English very well.
Ah, thank you. I don't speak English very well. But
beautiful.
Okay.
It blows off the tip of your tongue like a poet.
All right. Thank you very much. So now, let's go ahead with the first segment of the today. First of all, Jim, would you introduce yourself?
My name is Jim. Jim Borden. I'm originally from upstate New York, but I live in Kazo right now. Kazo, Saitama, Japan, on the Saitama-Ibaraki border.
You went to volunteer last week. So if you want to know how Jim did his volunteer in Miyagi during the Golden Week of Japan, you should go check the archive from Yokoso News, which is available Yokoso News on YouTube as well. And then April.
Yes.
So would you introduce yourself, please?
Sure. I'm April, and I live in Kawasaki, and I've been down here for 22 years, and I'm from America. I'm from the East Coast, and I live actually just near Kawasaki JR Station.
Oh.
Kawasaki proper.
Oh, cool. So if I miss the last train at the Kawasaki station, I can bang the door.
Yeah, absolutely.
Can I?
Yes.
April,
yes,
can I stay?
Open.
Okay, good. Thank you. But, all right. Thank you very much.
I almost moved to Kawasaki.
Oh, okay. Okay. Well, I'm here from Yokohama, Japan, by the way. So today I actually have a small background music turning on.
Music by Kevin MacLeod.
Okay. Good morning, Liz. this is recording. Yes, I'm recording. But April.
Yeah.
So Jim, you can always interrupt.
Moo.
Yeah, the question. But April, would you introduce yourself?
Sure. I live down here in Kawasaki, as I said, and I've been here since in this area since my arrival here in Japan. I've always lived down here, and I work for myself. And I'm an English teacher for research scientists and doctors and nurses, that kind of area, nuclear engineers. And then I also teach jazz styling and bossa nova styling and R&B styling to professional musicians, not only singers, but pianists and trumpet players and guitarists and et cetera.
Cool.
And I play and I'm, and I, yeah. That's what I do, and lots of volunteer projects these days as well.
Cool. So let's keep promoting, keep mentioning about your show throughout the show. So,
okay.
What are you? So I heard that you are gonna plan to do something July 3rd.
That's right. I'm producing a rather large concert with a group of amazing musicians, four different groups in the Kawasaki Sangyo Shinko Kaiken for charity. It is everybody's volunteering, the four different groups, and we're trying to raise at least 1 million yen, if not more, to take up to the Miyagi area to use for different things. I'm not sure what yet, though, but, you know, to do something that will really help. And anyway, we're doing this great concert down here, which I'll be happy to tell you more about later.
Cool. Yeah.
Unless you want to tell you now.
let's keep saying July 3rd at the Kawasaki Sangyo Kaikan.
That's right.
So, all right, cool. So you've been living in Japan for 22 years. Oh my God, that's a long time.
Yeah.
That's longer than I'm in Japan, I think, actually. No, I'm about 30 years old, and I was away for the U.S. for like 7-8 years.
Uh-huh.
So, it's about you and I kind of live in Japan at about the same time. So,
I've only been alive for 25
okay,
years.
You can stop right there, Jim.
Yeah. Harry Covier, hey, where's that bowl of curry come from? I don't know.
From Katz's kitchen, of course.
I think so, but it's not from Sarah's last weekend's contest, but I just had to make it one more time for tonight. But anyway, I'm sorry for the curry dog, April. I'm sorry.
Oh, don't worry.
Okay. Tell me, how are you doing during the earthquake?
Well, I didn't get a chance to tell you this earlier, but I was maybe one of the lucky ones. I had just flown out of Japan about 18 hours before it happened.
Oh.
And I had just landed in Brazil, where I had waited to go for 15 years. And when I had landed, I was with some Japanese and Brazilian friends that live here. We had landed, and about 6 hours after we actually got settled, then we got the call about the earthquake. And we very quickly came back. we weren't able to do our trip. I did a little bit of my trip, but the other guys had to come back. So I wasn't actually here for the rocking and the rolling, but of course emotionally I was. But you know, I wasn't here physically until about 1 week after I came back.
Okay. So how was it when you came back, and then how are you now in Kawasaki, Kanagawa?
It was good. Well, you know, there was a lot of concern about Kawasaki because it shook quite violently here. And I was in touch with friends very quickly, not through phone, but other sources I had. And there was some damage in some of my friends' houses. We thought my building might fall down because it's 55 years old, but it was fine. And there was minor damage, interior product, you know, interior things, lamps, etc. The trains were quite dodgy when I got back. There was nothing regular, and you didn't know if they were going to come or not come. There was no schedule or regularity at all, even minor regularity. But now we're back to a more consistent time schedule, but the trains are basically cut down. It's maybe at about 70% of the regular number of trains. Mm.
But I know it's a little bit less convenient, but it's like people jammed, or how is it? Okay.
It's intense. Oh. It gets packed up. You know, late nights used to always be packed coming back from Tokyo, and because you know, Friday, especially Friday nights, everybody parties, they go out later. But when you come from Tokyo back down here late nights, if there's any problems at all, even a minor earthquake or an aftershock, it really causes havoc. So I've gotten stuck in Tokyo trying to get back here on Friday nights can't get home until maybe 2 a.m., 2:30 a.m. Whereas I normally get back by latest 1.
So when's that? When was that?
Still now.
Oh, still now? Is that the same board in there in Kazuo as well?
I think April might be... Are you talking about driving?
No.
Or the train?
I'm talking about the trains.
Oh, I didn't know the trains ran that late, because they definitely don't run that late here.
Okay.
No, well, they don't run that late normally, but when there's trouble, they can't just stop the trains, right? Their trains are delayed because there may be just a small aftershock. It really messes up the system. But they won't stop until the normal last train, but it may be delayed by an hour. I mean, it's just crazy.
I've noticed delays too, but they're from not as many from the aftershocks here anymore, but just delays for other reasons.
Okay. So Kawasaki is Kawasaki has little bit of the public transportation kind of nightmare kind of thingy, but in a way it's not like end of the world. Like,
no, and it's not like it was just after the earthquake by any means. And the other thing, the one other thing that has remained consistent is the light off situation. The stores are still quite dark, and only half the ticket machines in the station are usable, and they're being very, very careful.
Well, but they are because they're conserving
energy. Sure. Yeah. And they're sticking with it, but I find in Tokyo, because I work up in Tokyo sometimes, they're not.
Yeah. Okay.
It's interesting.
All the escalators are off around here.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, anyway.
But basically okay.
Okay. Got it.
All functionable.
All right, cool. So okay, so now let's go into the main topic of the top story of the day. So Jim went to Miyagi last week. Two weeks ago. So now April, I heard that you just came back from Miyagi.
I did. I came back at midnight last night.
Oh.
So earlier than when you come home from work.
Yeah. Yeah, we'll live, we will. Yeah.
So tell me about your experience. By the way, how did you get to know Yokoso News at the first place?
Oh, you actually came to me from a friend in America.
Really?
Who has had a lot of time, spent a lot of time here in Japan. And I was still desperately trying to find information and news, and just, I was crazy. Huh. And she let me know right away. As soon as I came back from Brazil, she said, oh, wait, I've got a source for you. Go to Yokoso News. And that's how I found you.
Oh, cool.
From outside to the inside.
I see. Thank you very much. So how was my reporting to you?
Oh, fabulous and so comforting. And so, I was so relieved to just hear what was being said here from the news sources and just direct translations and just sort of updating me on what was the actual reporting from in here. I had the outside news, but I didn't have the news from inside on a consistent basis. And I thank you for that.
No problem. But I just going to mention, because Yokoso News is originally entertainment media, I wasn't really designed this as a journalism, so I don't have the resources, like 100 reporter. So what I'm doing, the direct translation from Japanese government press releases, main media's sources. So, you know, I keep saying this, you should believe what the Japanese government says as much as your government in your country says. You should believe what the Japanese mainstream media say as much as your country's mainstream media says. But it's as much as I'm able to provide the information to you in English, then hopefully it's going to help you to add the one more aspect of the information during this disaster. But you know, after 2 months, it's it's already 2 months. It's I can't believe it's already 2 months. But after 2 months, Fukushima nuclear reactor situation is still critical. Very critical. And INES 7 critical. And then last weekend, one of the worker died because it wasn't the radiation, but because of the harsh working environment. Because they have to wear the protective suits double. They had to, you know, then they won't be able to, you know, swipe their sweat. So, the worker who was in 60s years old, he was, he had a heart attack. And so, that's, you know, harsh working environment there. But still, it's getting a little bit stabler. Still, it's critical. Still around Fukushima nuclear power plant, it's dangerous. In around 20 kilometers radius, and then also Itate village, which I'm going to talk about. But we getting a little bit more relaxed, and then so I now shifting my focus more towards the first-hand information, like how people are reconstructing themselves, how first-hand information. So that's why I'm getting less focus on the regular update. You can go to Kyodo News, you can go to NHK World to get the latest up-to-date news, but I really want to bring you shifting the focus more towards this first-handed social media kind of the information. So now, April, I'm sorry for the old sidetrack.
No problem.
So
it's right into it.
Yeah. You did a fantastic job about the. I heard already great stuff from you. So tell me. So what did you do in short summary?
I I gathered a group of 20 volunteers. Most of them are people that I knew or friends of friends. And I gathered them up, and I gathered some money the best way I could in 9 days, and gathered everything else that I might need to hold a Brazilian, Peruvian barbecue event up in Miyagi, in Koganehama, for some of the citizens up there.
That's in short.
That's what we did. Well, that's in short, but it was complicated.
So let me hear the complication of your journey then. So so how did you? Well, why did you start doing this volunteer at the beginning?
One friend of mine knew about me planning this charity concert in Kawasaki for July 3rd and thought that maybe because I was active in that, I might have some connections or know how to plan maybe another charity event or might have some other ideas in the works. Not. You know, planning a charity event at home is one thing, but in a foreign country and this kind of event, this kind of situation is so extreme and so different. So anyway, somebody said, hey, I have a friend that has money and will pay for a whole lot of meat for a barbecue event. Do you have one planned? Not. And it was like, but my brain started working very quickly, and I said, they have the meat. That's the most expensive part of a barbecue. I probably know the people that would go up and do this. I've heard enough people say they want to do something. And then my brain worked a little quicker and said, I wonder if I can pull this off. I wonder if I can get enough money, charity money, using Facebook and friends and word of word, you know, from person to person and word of mouth. I wonder how fast I can do this. I wonder how fast these people will activate. And so anyway, I took the challenge and I thought, okay, I got the meat. Now I got to just get the rest of the food and the people and the cars and the money and the et cetera. And we can do this. So that's how it started. Just one person calling and saying, somebody's got money to pay for this. And this beat, and can we do something with that?
How come you were able to be surrounded by such encouraging people in Kanagawa, Kawasaki? I'm sorry, Kawasaki.
In Kawasaki?
Yeah.
Well, you know, I have a lot of friends that I don't know. How did I find so many encouraging and encouraged friends? You know, I don't know. I think the earthquake changed a lot of people to begin with. And a lot of compassion just started pouring out of people, especially Niseis, second generation Japanese Peruvians and Brazilian Peruvians, however you want to switch it. And I just heard a lot of people constantly saying, I want to do something, I want to do something, but nobody knew how or where to go with it except for to do contributions to large organizations, which is so distant from seeing a hands-on situation. So, and I heard them saying that, and I just kept remembering it and thinking, okay, now is my opportunity. I wonder if they'll really come forward. And once I contacted people and said, okay, you want to try this? You really want to go? They all started saying yes.
That's the, you know, I mean, I on the social timeline, people say, yes, I want to help, but they don't know where and how. So, but first of all, how were you able to, like, get a connection to the person? Yeah.
Okay. I had heard of a few friends that had been doing some volunteer work up north as musicians, playing for the lines, playing in the soup kitchens, we call them soup kitchens, or the charity food events, and because they're long lines when these people go to get food in some of these areas, and it's cold or it's hot, and what do you do in line, you know? So some of my musician friends had gone up and had connected with other people people that were organizing events and had collected names. And so I just tapped sources and I called them and I said, do you know somebody up in the Miyagi area? Do you know somebody that might need a barbecue event? Do you know? And I just kept connecting wherever I thought there might be an answer or a friend that would lead me to another person with an answer. And it happened very quickly. I happened to tap the right source.
Via what? Like Facebook?
Via music? No.
Via music. Okay.
Musicians. Okay. That I'd had conversations with at parties or events or, you know, everybody's socializing down here constantly. You know, we run into each other all over the place.
So you had a network of the musician who have been already doing something up north then?
That's right.
Okay, got it.
And so, I thought they might have some connections to people actually organizing events up there.
Yeah, because that's the one of the reasons why Yokosunyusi is still Yokaichimi in Japan, because I was getting ready to organize like national network of the volunteer, but they get connected to the people, but I'm not ready. I wasn't ready to get. I didn't know people like April, so that's why this is what I can do. I just gonna be in Yokaichimi, Japan, collect information from my side and spread the information to connect the information. So, but you had you knew the right person then.
Knew the right person that led me to the next right person, which was a group of it's a church, one of the churches up in Tokyo. There are several churches very active, and there's one minister in one of these churches is sort of coordinating the other churches to actually do hands-on and adopt neighborhoods, basically, or adopt a kinjo of about 5 streets across by 5 streets, right? Mm. 5 by 5. And it's so this one man, so anyway, that's how things started. I got connected to this one main church called Grace City Church, and then the director of that church, who's also directing all these other churches as to what's needed where and when, called me directly. He didn't have somebody under him or one of the other churches call me. He called me himself, this main director and coordinator for all these Tokyo churches. And he's just amazing, and he's got his hands on everything up there. And he's up there constantly himself. So he said, you want to throw a barbecue party, huh? I said, well, I don't know if it's a party, but we'll bring some food up and cook it for you guys. And he said, okay, we got just the place for you. I said, oh, yeah? Okay, great. How many people? He said, 250. I went, oh, no. You know, I was thinking maybe 60 or 100. I've never cooked for that many. But I took on the challenge. I said, okay, we're going to do this. We'll do this. So that was the next step, finding the location and the person to take us there.
Okay. Then, so you found the location from the church?
That's right, then, and found the community to take us there.
Mm. How did you find the community? What kind of community? What's
well,
community?
This church, the church is actually, if somebody wants to do an activity in one of the areas that a church is working in, they'll actually escort you up there so that you don't get lost. They're there to help you with the activity. They're there to help explain the situation and who are some of the people in the neighborhood, and they don't just send you up there by yourself. That's a very hands-on, all the way around situation, so that we weren't nervous going up because we didn't really know where we were going. We knew the general area, but we didn't, you know, and how to go there and what time and how long will it take and what are we doing, right? So, and that was very, very helpful. And that's a great way to do it, because as just a group of friends, you know, we don't have a big NPO or NGO or, you know, organization and not a lot of money. And we really are just a group of friends that wanted to go up and help some other new friends. So it really helped to have that church to our that church, and no paperwork and none of the long red tape. They just said, this is what we need, this is how many people, this is where we can meet you, this is how long it'll take to drive, this is what time, this is what we'll do for you up there. And they never left our side. The whole time we were up there throwing the barbecue, and the citizens were coming. So it was a really nice, gentle situation, a great way to be introduced to volunteering up there as a group.
Okay. So if you could organize something to cater 200, couple hundred people, those church will coordinate, help you coordinate to hook you, kind of hook both parties up. Then.
That's right.
Okay.
Hook up the volunteers to the community,
okay,
to which location. And we didn't want to be part of a bigger volunteer, you know, like an NGO or MPO or the prefecture, because that's when you kind of lose control of what exactly you want to do or what is really needed, one-to-one kind of basis. And I really wanted to do something one-to-one. From our citizens, we just kept calling ourselves the Kawasaki citizens are going up to see the Kuganehama citizens and to be with them. And so this was one way to keep control of the whole situation and make it something we could deal with, because we didn't need a whole lot of money. We needed some. I mean, we needed it fast and we needed to do it cheap but we wanted to supply what they needed too. So anyway, it worked. It worked beautifully.
I didn't really ask you, can I ask how much did you have to get ready?
You mean money-wise?
Yeah. I mean, if you don't want to talk about it, that's okay.
No, that's fine. I can give you a general where I'm still doing some of the accounting, because there's still a little bit more coming in. We took some out of our pockets, but a little bit out of our own pockets, but mostly it was done by charity. We were able to do this. I was able to do this, and I had a really great friend, an Aussie friend, that sort of stepped in and came in on the last half and really boosted the whole thing up a bit and helped me raise some funds and get cheaper food from friends and this and that, you know, distributors. But anyway, we raised, I think I was able to raise maybe 300,000 yen in about 7 days. Yes,
30
man. And, or maybe a little bit less. Need you go man.
Okay.
Now, and that made us nervous, because we had to rent a refrigerator truck.
Yeah.
Because it's too hot up there.
Yeah.
Had to rent a van. Had to pay for the highway tolls.
Yeah.
And had to pay for gas. And had to pay for the rest of the food, because all we had was the meat.
Okay.
And we wanted to take things for the kids.
Yeah.
So we were a little bit nervous about that. But it was between 250,000 and 300,000. And we did it. We did it. We thought we were going to have to borrow money from the church to pay for the highway tolls, but we actually pulled that off as well, you know, at the last minute. And the highway tolls are quite expensive.
Yeah.
And the government wouldn't help us with that,
yeah,
although we tried to get help, but they wouldn't. So that's about it. Yeah.
So how much were for the actual goods and how much for the actual transportation?
Oh, I haven't divided that out,
okay,
but probably, I can tell you roughly.
Okay.
It was about half.
Okay.
Because the gas and diesel and the tolls and the rental of the driving, it was about half.
Okay. So half for the transportation and then half of the goods and stuff. All right, cool.
That's right.
So that's for the to feed about 300 people on the weekend.
No,
huh?
No, we were able to feed 250. We had actually originally the number was 150, and then it kind of kept going up and up. And then we just, once we got there, they said, okay, it's 200. And they said, no, we got 50 more around the corner. And we actually had been very, very generous with the meat in the beginning. And I think people had way too much food. They looked at it and were like, I can't possibly eat all this food. If we had kind of controlled it a little bit more, we probably would have been able to feed about 400 people.
Mm. Okay. Yeah. So that's
but
for 2 days.
It's all very, that's for one lunch, right?
One lunch, okay.
Yeah, one lunch. But I have a much better, I'm very clear about how that works now. I mean, it just takes one time of doing it. So I'm going to write up some guidelines for other communities. If they want to go and do this in other areas, I'm writing up guidelines for the church, and I'm going to also post them maybe on your site.
Yeah.
A few guidelines on how to do this quite cheaply, because that's not that expensive.
Mm. Okay.
I mean, Sanman or Samangosan, for a group of 20 people, I mean, they could actually pitch it in themselves and do this.
Mm.
And it made a big difference.
Mm.
We could see it made a difference. At least for a day, it made a difference. And, you know, a day up there is like a year. It's so rough up there. So, anyway, does that help?
Sure, sure. I mean, yeah, thank you very much for all the insight. Because, you know, this stuff, like, we need to, one day, maybe we couldn't do it this time, but we could probably do it next time. So, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So, tell me, that was the preparation part of the day. So, tell me about, like, when did you leave for Miyagi?
Well, we left on Sunday night at 12 midnight. And with a caravan in tow. And we left from Kawasaki. And then we went to the Sano service station, a service exit, they call it.
Ooh, that's
we
right
picked
next to
up
me.
Our. Oh, yeah?
It's the next, the two service areas after mine.
See, we should have picked you up and taken us.
You can next time. I'm always ready.
We will. Okay, we will, because we want to go again. And then we picked up our escorts from the church, and they were waiting for us there. And we also picked up another volunteer that lives near there and wanted to come with us.
Okay.
So there we off. Off we went.
So you took Tohoku Expressway?
Yep.
How many cars?
Five after the Sano service exit.
Okay. Yep. So how were you able to put together those five cars?
Well, that was kind of interesting because it was a last minute terror. We had somebody giving us a van to use, but that kind of collapsed at the last minute, which put the finances into a little bit of a tailspin. But we were able to rent a van. I found a really cheap place here in Kawasaki that would rent us a van for 15 people. I knew it would be cramped, but that's okay. And one other local person said they were willing to drive their car. And we knew we needed a nice truck, so we rented that. And we just fought to get enough money to keep it in the budget. And then the rest just, you know, was natural. You know, people wanted our guides from the church had a car. And then the other person in Upper Tokyo had a car. So that's how it happened.
Now I'm showing the picture of Eri Kobayashi, who is also on the social timeline. Thank you, Eri, for sharing this picture as well. Thank you for April introducing everybody to us, by the way.
Yeah.
Then you took the expressway all the way up.
We did.
And then when you get there, how long did it take you from Kawasaki
to where
did you go first?
Well, we went actually directly to the city Ishinomaki, but the area we were in was the Koginehama. And we first of all, we went up on a a small mountain or a large hill, depending, where this was where people ran when the tsunami started to come. And there were houses up there. It's a beautiful hill with schools and houses which were basically untouched, which was amazing. I mean, they had a few cracks in walls, but it was basically fine, this area. So the guides took us up there and said, we feel like you need to see what this is all about. And the best way to do that is to get a bird's eye view. So they took us up to this park up on the top of the mountain, and we could see 360 degrees around this area.
Yeah.
And that you've got pictures of that.
Yeah.
So that was a real wake-up call as to where we were, because we had just driven through part of the town and we could see no stores were open. They were boarded up. There wasn't mud or dirt in the streets in the center of the town, but one of our volunteers with us had been there 6 weeks before and was there cleaning up that mud. And he said it was totally different, but we had just gone through the center. We could see some debris, but we weren't into the neighborhoods yet, nor near the beach area. So once we went up on this hillside, we started looking over, and, you know, I had some strong guys with me from Brazil and Peru and Australia, and I saw a lot of tears. I saw some teary eyes. When they started looking at the devastation, it was intense, because this area has an ocean and a river, and it's saltwater, freshwater river. So they got hit by the tsunami and they got hit by the flooding of the river. So it was intense, and the cuts. I'll tell you, the first thing that hit me was the smell. It was so strong up there. It was a mix of everything you can imagine, you know. And nobody talked about it. Everybody just looked at each other and we're like, yeah, okay, we can smell it and we don't know what it is, but it's okay. It's just what it is, you know. So anyway, with them, that's where our guides took us first. And they pointed to an area in one direction and pointed, and they said, you see that area over there, you know, near the ocean and near the river? That's where we're taking you to do your barbecue. This is the area that we've adopted. So we had it was a very good introduction to the whole scenario. And it gave us a moment to kind of breathe before we saw the people. And so we kind of understood a little bit of what it looked like, what they were dealing with, etc.
That's really nice introduction. Yeah,
it was. They knew exactly what they were doing. And it was gentle and it was soft, and they were there with us, and they had lots of information for us, and they told us what had changed and what hadn't changed, and they were really amazing.
Would you share me with that information?
Of course. Do you want it now, or you want me to post it with you? Post it for you.
No. I want it now. As far as you remember right now, just to share briefly.
Wait a minute. You mean the people that guided us?
No. What's the update? What has been changed?
What's changed? Oh, I'll tell you. The area closest to the beach, to just the beach, but not the river, what they've done is they've blocked it off now, and you could see some military and some construction companies down in that area. They've gone ahead and knocked down all of the structures that were half standing. And you probably have seen some of that on the news. Like, they warn people, if you want to get anything, you got to go in there, and they will send somebody with you to see if you can get pictures or whatever, because we're going to knock down these structures.
Yeah.
So that, we saw one area that had been, well, it was already flat from the tsunami, but if there was anything left half up, it was knocked down. A lot of the cars in this area that was right next to the beach, and I mean, it was quite large, some of the cars were then moved from, you know, a lot of cars were moved by the water and slammed up against houses, or, you know, just crunched up against each other. They've begun to collect those into one location, and I've heard that they're going to have a recycle plant that deals with metal come and pick up all the cars and the trucks and the boats that are 3 and 4 blocks in from the ocean because those are really hard to move. So anyway, that's beginning. That's in one area. If you can imagine, this mountain is right in the middle of the city. So you can, like I say, you can see all the way around. So that's one area. There are lots of areas that have not even been touched yet. That it's still in total devastation, and that's one of the areas we went to hold the barbecue. They have started more classes for the kids, thank goodness. A lot of the kids were not in school until 4 days ago, and they were just going stark raving mad. Of course, the kids were bored to tears and too depressed. So they finally said, okay, we're going to open up some of the rooms in the shelters, which are the high schools and the junior high schools. We're going to open some of the rooms for classrooms. So that's a new change. That's a really big change for this community, really big, because they just didn't know if they would ever have any classes available. So, and teachers have volunteered to come in. Some teachers aren't even being paid, but they're volunteering to come in and teach. So that's one thing that's changed. They told me in the city proper, right in the center of the town, the new big thing is another convenience store opened. They've only had one for 6 weeks in the whole town. There are no grocery stores. There's nothing else. That's it. There's just one convenience store.
By the way, now picture is taken by Gabriel Siguemoto. Thank you very much for sharing these pictures. Go ahead.
Oh, good. I'm not even looking at them. I guess I should, so in case something comes up that you need me to comment on. But anyway, so that's one thing. And then they said there is a little bit more electricity in some of the more remote areas. Oh, those are some of my volunteers. There's a little bit more electricity, but in the areas we were in, it was daytime only. I mean, nighttime only. Daytime, there was no electricity. There's also a large problem still in a lot of the areas with the toilet and the sewer system. So, but there, it's getting better, but very slowly, very, very slowly in this community. So you can see. And just really quickly, while you're looking at that picture, you see how the first floor of these places is basically destroyed? A lot of people are living on the second floors of their houses. They don't want to go to the shelters. But anyway, that's distracting from the point. And what's changed? So anyway, step by step, but there's still no grocery stores. So the government is bringing in food and giving it away that one or two times a week, vegetables, etc. But very basic stuff. Really, really big. No butter, no milks. They don't have refrigeration to take care of it. So, very basic life.
I see. Icarus flies again. I'll answer your question after the section. Then you moved in to the area where you're going to barbecue. Where is this place exactly?
It's about 3 blocks. Oh, maybe a little bit more. 4 blocks from the ocean and the river, like where they intersect, where the river starts from the ocean. And really damaged. But this, we went in about, like I say, a little bit further into this neighborhood where they had cleared out this space. As you can see right now, they're putting down a white tarp. The church had asked one of the landowners, this was going to be built there, so it was already a kind of a blank, semi-blank piece of land. And the church went to the neighbors and said, we need a place to have events and have meetings and to distribute water and to give you food and to build fires and whatever. And one of the guys that lives in a house right near there said, yes, of course you can use this land for that. So they brought in, they cleaned up the land, they took out of the debris the church members and the local community, cleared away the debris from this one small little area, and graveled it. The church brought in the gravel, and now they have just an open space that the community can use for anything, and they also know that's where they can get food and water if there's anybody bringing it. So... But we were sort of surrounded. You can see a few houses standing, but believe me, the first floor was gone, basically.
Yeah, I see.
So, okay.
So then you looks like you finished setting up and you start doing the barbecue. How was it?
Oh, it was fun. Setting up was a little complicated because they don't have anything there, of course. So we had to sort of, we found some old kind of destroyed furniture and covered it over to use as tabletops. We were very resourceful. Mm. We brought some stuff with us, but we had limited space. And we wanted to bring food more than tables. You know, we wanted to bring water more than anything. Mm. And juice and fruits and things. So we just opted and said, we'll figure it out how to serve this. So we set up, got the grills going. We had four grills, two professional size grills, two restaurants had lent us, which was amazing. And then two friends gave us two smaller grills that we were going to use for potatoes. And the guys, we had some professional barbecuers or longtime barbecuers, and they just started heating up those grills and cooking up all the sausage and steak and chicken you could even imagine. And I had another crew working on all the salads and the breads, and we took things that we knew they hadn't had for quite a while, like lettuce. They have only cabbage there. They don't have lettuce. And celery is unheard of in this area. I sort of checked on that. And we took food that we know they hadn't had for a while, and fresh strawberries and watermelon and cake, and oh, we went crazy. And we set up, and before we knew it, and way before we were ready, we had a line.
Okay.
Of hungry people.
I see. Aries said 2 kilometers from the coast, so it's about 1.5 miles from the coast.
Right. Now that's the coast, but we were close to the river.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, she's thinking the coastline. We were at the intersection.
So, okay. April, you kind of start breaking up your voice.
That's because it's the 1 hour marker. Hold on, I'm going to hang up. I'll call you right back.
Okay.
Are you calling? I'm going to hang up on you.
Okay, all right, got it. I'll wait for you. All right, that was April. Okay, what do you think?
Sounds like Star Trek.
Yeah. Oh, we start losing April. Oh, my God.
No, you said she went to Ishinomaki. That's the same place I went.
Yeah, so do you think, are you familiar with the location? She said near the river.
Well, I don't know. We didn't know anything about Ishinomaki because we just went there without anybody's help.
Okay, hold on. Sorry.
No, I'm sorry.
I need to. I needed to call you. But
okay, sorry.
It's okay.
You got me.
Sorry, I forgot. So, Jim Borden also went to Ishinomaki two weeks ago. So you guys kind of went to the same place. So why April Ishinomaki? I mean, I knew that church people kind of set you up, but why church people ask you to go to Ishinomaki, not the other places?
Oh, to Koginehama in Ishinomaki.
Yeah.
They actually had asked us originally to go to another area for another time. I tell you, I think this church actually is involved in several areas.
Mm.
And the other churches are also involved in some of the neighborhoods, and they're trying to make sure that all the neighborhoods are getting advantage of the volunteers that want to help.
Mm.
So they're sort of divvying it up, you know. And this area was due for some love and care. So they said, okay, now it's time for this neighborhood.
Mm.
And these churches really aim to go where they found the most destruction, and it's what the feeling I'm getting from talking to several of them. Mm. And also, other charity groups were involved in that area and needed to be kind of coordinated, like clothing groups and people providing soaps and water, etc. And he said, okay, there seems to be a need for a coordinator up here and some more help up in these areas, so let's join up there and see if we can't get everything moving a little bit more smoothly for these people, because they knew the government was going to be very, very slow to clean up this area, so they were going to be the longer time sufferers, mm. is what they said to me. And also, you know, some of the local people, we talked to them too, and they said, this, we're in for the long, long, long haul here, mm. because there's so many cars. Jim, I'm not sure exactly where you were. You were there 2 weeks ago. You saw cars and debris everywhere, right?
Yeah, I have pictures of all that too. Cars everywhere.
Yeah. I saw your pictures. I mean, there's nothing. Nothing has been touched in this particular one neighborhood. So I think that's why they're focusing on this area. It's something. It's a place where they can do hands-on and get to know the neighbors, and see what their needs are, and help them in a more controlled, small way. Because this is maybe in each area, it's 200 to 400 people. That's a dealable number. Mm. You can actually affect it. And when these people were waiting in line for lunch, the church and there were other friends that help them, and they have lots of groups that help them, then not only church, but they were walking through the lines taking names and taking down lists of what do these people need this week. Mm. What do they need this week? And shampoo or a bicycle pump, I heard one man say. And somebody said, I need a tub to wash my clothes in. And they do this. This church does this every week. They take the list, go back, do the shopping in another town or even Tokyo, and come back 2 days later and deliver this stuff. Mm. That's that, and it's making a big difference. And I really think this hands-on thing, and I really encourage people, don't be afraid. If you got a community of friends, I you can do this. We only had 20 people, but we were going to do it with 15. We could do it with 15. You don't need a lot of people.
Mm. But you only had 10.
Yeah, you still need a dozen people, I think.
Oh, so, yeah. Yeah. Well, it depends. Oh, yeah. Sure, yeah. If you're going to cook for 250. Yeah. But, you know, they actually need people to come up and go through some of the land again to look for just pictures. Mm. Now, if you put a group of 10 people and you get through a neighbor, you could get through a neighborhood. Mm. You could do 10 houses and find the pictures or more. You could find things for them because they're still in that stage after even 2 months. Mm. Yeah, so... That's just, you know, I'm not sure we're getting the full picture from the news as to really how bad it is still in some of these areas.
Now going back to Eri's picture. Okay, yeah, yeah.
That's me.
Huh?
I'm seeing my picture. Who's that? Oh, okay, never mind. I'll refresh.
Your banner's still up.
Oh, sure. Oh, sorry. sorry, I forgot to switch it. Sorry.
It's okay.
So no, I'm sorry. Then I'm going to Eri's picture.
Okay. Oh yeah. Oh well, there you go.
Eri said near Onagawa River. They said that we are so used to waiting for anything.
Mm,
I see.
Yeah. Eddie got a little bit of chance to tell. She was able to talk to some of the people a little bit more than the rest of us. She was trying to peddle the toys, you know, give away the toys and the children's things and try to meet some of the kids.
I saw that from the Gabriel's picture. Then this is it too, Eddie's picture. So you were giving away some toys to the kids?
Oh, yeah. We loaded. Oh, you know, I wish I had a picture of my bicycle in there. You know, I don't have a car, but I had to do all the shopping on my bike, right? So my obituary, my my limousine, I call it my bicycle.
Mama Chari.
Yes, so.
Mama Chari. I have a Mama Chari too.
Oh, I can't live without mine, man. You should have seen me carting this stuff around on my bikes. I look like I was starting a store in my house. But anyway, I made a decision to buy children's toys children's sports activities for all ages to get the kids interactive and moving their bodies. I was really thinking what to give them, and we need them to move, right, and to be in community again, and to be with each other, and not just sitting and drawing or doing something that's by themselves. So I really focused on that, and oh my gosh, just lots of fun stuff. Any game you can think of with a friend, yeah, we gave them the supplies, so that was good.
I see. So how long was this barbecue? You just did it for one day, right?
Oh yeah. We arrived at like 7:30, went up on the mountain and had our breakfast up there and talked about the community, talked about the situation and, you know, et cetera. And then we came down and we started setting up at about 9 o'clock, 8:30, 9 o'clock, we started taking everything out of the truck, and by 11 o'clock, the line was there by almost 10:15. But we told everybody to start serving at 11, and then we worked until 2:30, about 2:30, 2 o'clock, and we just push for 3 solid hours of just cooking and serving and cooking and serving, and
now
by 2 o'clock,
I have
it was
you
done.
Cutting the watermelon.
Yeah, that's me. And it was delicious. I heard. None of the volunteers ate. We didn't have any time. It was unbelievable. But we didn't even feel hungry. You know, it was just, we just pushed and pushed so hard and just were so focused that all of us afterwards looked at each other and went, "Did you eat?" "No, did you eat?" Well, water. We drank a lot of water. So that was it. Yeah, so we finished. Anything we had left to cook was gone by 2. So then we had a few things, and the cakes and the watermelons and all that stuff. So then we had some water containers and stuff. We gave those away, and bottles of tea, we gave that away. We had some leftover vegetables, gave that away. And then we were done by about 2. And we packed up. And we left. We had to leave because we had to all work. Oh, I'm eating Eddie's hat. I'm so hungry. Then we packed it up and got back in our caravan and left and started home, on our way home. And that was so, and stopped at a couple of convenience stores and rest stops and caught our breath and kept going. So it was a 24-hour, it was crazy, but very, very rewarding in so many ways.
Nice.
Yeah, that does sound pretty crazy. We spaced it out, we were able to space it out a little bit more at least.
Yeah, I know, I remember
because
you saying.
Because you kind of slept in the car too, you went kind of early, Jim.
Yeah,
right?
Well, they did. I can't, I'm too tall.
Oh, that's right. I remember you said you had to get out of the car, and it was too hot, right, Jim?
Yeah. Oh, man. Well, there were 2 other people outside. The little elementary school girl was outside, too. So when I'm like, "Oh, what's going on?" And she's like, "Oh, the people in the truck are so noisy."
Oh, this was, we were very, there we are, some of us in the van. Oh, we had, you know, we had 7 nationalities in this group. It was wonderful. No, we just had a great time. Yes. And I was the common point. I knew everybody on the trip except for one person, but you know, I had met everybody and I knew everybody, and one Brazilian Japanese there. And everybody played their part. It was just tremendous. Everybody worked really hard and got along really well. And this man drove us both ways in our van. He has a special license. He said, "Okay, I'll do this for you." We're like, "Okay, thank you very much, and take care of us." And it was just amazing, amazing group. But you'll always know the right people. You know, once you put the word out there. So Facebook I used. I really used it in this. So once you put the word out, the people that are supposed to go really will respond. And the people that are supposed to give money will respond. And I was ruthless about getting money. I mean, if somebody said, okay, I can't go, but I'd like to donate, and then I wouldn't hear from them again, oh, I was on Facebook like a mad woman. So you want to donate?
You've just sold your soul.
Yeah, exactly. So you want to donate? How much do you think you might want to donate? This is how much we need. Oh, I was really bad.
We need it now.
And we really did, because we only had 9 days. So I was like, okay, I need this now. And then Duncan started, another guy started pulling in some money. And then one owner of a restaurant started telling customers. And sometimes I'd go up and sit in the restaurant, and we'd have like a really loud conversation about it to spike everybody's interest. And then I'd go up to the table and talk to strangers about it. It's embarrassing. But it was for such a good cause, and I knew this was right. So I knew it would be okay. So last night we just kept saying, wow, we did this. We did this. We really did this, and we're going to go do it again. So it was amazing.
Well, let me know, when are you going to do it again? Maybe I should join you guys or something.
Oh, that would be fabulous. Come with us. Oh, look at Eddie. Yes. You were starving. We were all starving. Oh, Katz, you would. It's, you know, the pictures and the videos and the stories are one thing, but I was telling my class this morning to see it and to touch it, just even as briefly as we did, and we had no time to really talk to people because we were really working hard and pushing hard, and we had to get out of there before the dark. Of course, because there are no lights. And Jim, you probably experienced this too, that there are no lights in the area. It's very dangerous.
We're like, it's 4 p.m. We got to start breaking down, or else we're never gonna get out of here.
And you were doing it 2 weeks ago. It's lighter now, but we were also worried about, you know, not getting on the Tohoku close to Tokyo, because it's kind of crazy late at night with the trucks. So many trucks at late at night in this area. So anyway, what was my point?
Well, just
volunteering is good. That was your point.
Oh yeah, volunteering is oh, Katz, come with us.
Yes.
Oh, I was saying that you really don't get it until you really see it. Mm-hmm. You really up close, especially in areas that have not been cleaned up, and the last thing I'll say is the strongest vision I had of the whole trip was we got a little bit misdirected as we were leaving our event. We ended up on some very back roads that were really in bad shape, but we were grateful that happened accidentally, because we could see areas, we could see the maximum of the destruction. Not that that made us happy, but we could get a real feeling for it. And we passed a cemetery that had gravestones that had been knocked over and cars were sitting on top of them, and it was on a hill. So I thought, the force of the water to drive these cars and these buses, literally buses sitting in graveyards, and they still haven't gotten to the graveyards yet, which is one of the precious things here, you know, to take care of the graves and wash them. I know that tradition. Those haven't been touched and cleaned up yet. I thought, oh boy, this is a bad situation here. These people really need help. So I'm going to do my best.
They're likely going to continue needing help for several years.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. So, and they said they're predicting that it's going to take 8 to 9 months to just clear it up enough to get the land so you can walk on it, you know, just the debris up. But it'll still be, you know, and anyway, they're saying 8 to 9 months of clearing up this land. This is the area near the beach. And there's the mountain we were looking over, so anyway. And that's the river.
Yeah.
And you probably saw the before and after picture, and there were boats up on the land, and it was just amazing. Mm. So, but I'm very, very glad we went. Very glad. It was time well spent and a good exhaustion. So again, I encourage people, don't be afraid of a small group, and don't have to go with NGOs, MPOs. You know, there are a lot of ways to get connected, and I'll be happy to share that news, I mean, that information. And there's a circuit going on. It's kind of the ground level circuit of people going up there to work, and we'll take you up. Okay. And that sounds like that's what you did, Jim. You were with just a family, right?
Not even a family, just a bunch of random people.
Yeah, well, there you go. And that's the best way to go, because it makes a difference. Did you finally get people to come and eat?
Well, we tried our best.
Can you come with us? We have no problem.
Yeah, I was screaming into the megaphone, come eat our food. You drove all around, and I'm screaming in Japanese like 50 times.
Well, I'll tell you, they had three hundred more that wanted to come, but we were out of food. We were done. You know, we just didn't. So somebody else came and got the 300 and said, come with us. We'll give you some soba. Oh, gosh, kawaii, so.
Oh, no.
Not exactly steak, sausage, and chicken, but we'll make up for it. Yeah,
we brought food for 300 and used it on 60.
It's all right. Well, I know how to do this now. Mm. I know what's going on now, and I feel like I've got a handle on this. I mean, it may change each time, but I feel like I've got a basic handle on this, how to do this now. Mm. So.
And it'll be nice to go with other people's English this time.
Cool. So, Ari, it's nice that... it's nice that the Ari posted that. So thank you for reminding me, Ari. By the way, Gabriel, thank you for sharing these gorgeous picture as well as Ari. It's nice. That's nice picture that I think that was your toy, April.
Yeah.
That you gave out to this nice little girl.
Oh, yeah. I'm not sure who that is, as I can't see on the side. Yeah. Oh, that was the mom and the daughter.
Yeah.
Yeah, those are the toys. Yeah, even for little kids, we had rackets. We had rackets of every size you can imagine. And frisbees galore and jump ropes for days. And there's just all kinds of goodies. Hmm. So, but we got to do it again, too. So, Katz, you come with us. We'd love to have you.
Okay, cool.
Much fun. Okay, so charity concert.
Yeah, charity concert. So tell me about the charity concert.
Okay, the charity concert is, they're going to be Western musicians and Japanese musicians. Two of the musicians are American. All the Western musicians have lived here for 20 years or more. And Bruce is a shakuhachi player, classical and jazz. And Chris is a koto player. Curtis is a koto player and a teacher. Both of them are teachers. And they have a group, and they're going to be performing. And Bruce is up in a lot of the areas right now playing shakuhachi while people wait in line for food. He entertains them. Then we've got a second group of Australians, didgeridoo, soprano sax, traditional flutes, Japanese percussion, Western percussion, and marimba. And they write their own original music and mix with the Asian flavor. Mm. Then I got my two groups. And I decided this time, I usually use Brazilians and Japanese mixed or sometimes Argentinians. This time, I have two groups, and they're all Japanese. One group is Japanese men, and they're young men, and they're very good musicians from all over Japan, believe it or not. And then I have another jazz group of all Japanese jazz women musicians. Mm. And
do you have a flyer?
We're making it. We got delayed because of the barbecue, right? It sort of put everything back 9 days. Okay. But I'm almost done, and I will be happy to send it to you.
Okay. Well, then maybe you should come back live when to promote your thing then. Cool. Any question that you want to ask? Actually, before we do Sakura, I haven't finished the update yet. Before that, actually, I have one event that I like to promote. This Sunday morning in Nagoya, there is going to be walkathon. It's a charity, like a walkathon, charity event organized by ACCJ, American Chamber of Commerce of Japan, in Nagoya area. And then they're going to have the walkathon charity event. This is the 20th anniversary event. So obviously, this is a charity event. So all the proceeds going to the donation. So if you live in around Nagoya area, I'm actually planning to just make a short visit to a walkathon to check out what's going on there. But yeah. So this is the upcoming event that I want to have a plug into. But so yeah, maybe you should yeah, I'd love to have you come back.
Okay, soon. I'd love to.
Yeah,
that'd be great.
And then also maybe now I know you, so maybe I'd love to come back for Yokoso News regular program sometime too.
Oh, I'd love that. That'd be great. And you know, Katz, you know, because I know now some of these people that are also up in these areas on a more regular basis. And, you know, like we were talking about Roger, this amazing organ player that takes his organ in his van and plays gospel music up in these areas, or swing music. And his wife is also a classical pianist. Sometimes they play dance music for people out of their van. And, you know, there's amazing, interesting people that are sort of, you know, just kind of in the background, but amazing stories, truly. I'm hearing more and more. It just makes my head shake. It cracks me up. It's wonderful how active people have become and compassionate. And I find it interesting that Japanese have such a strong reaction to when they think of foreigners going out and helping. I said, no, this is home for me. You know, this is my home. I've been here 22 years. I've been here half my life. This is home. That's how we feel. So I think they're kind of getting, things are just shifting because of this. Oh, I think that's good.
By the way, you just kind of disclose how old you almost are.
Oh no. Damage control.
That's okay. You did too.
Yeah, but I'm a guy, so I don't really care, but
I'll be happy to tell you how old I am.
I know I know how young you are.
Oh.
You're much younger than us. You don't know anything about Japan yet.
Oh no. Oh. Teach me.
Gordon, I think you should come with us when we volunteer next time.
Yeah. I'm so totally ready.
Okay, so let's get you guys on board.
Cool. Maybe I seriously going to cancel the trip to Los Angeles, and maybe I just gonna stay.
Well, really?
Yeah, then save that money for the volunteer to the north or something, huh?
Oh, Katz, I'll tell you that. Okay, now I'm motivated. Here we go. I'm motivated again. I'm going to plan another one quick.
don't do it quick. Don't do it quick, please.
No, I got to get my concert on set. Yeah. But I'm thinking about doing one in June. And almost all of the people that worked with us yesterday have all said, okay, so when are we going again? When are we going again? Okay, I need to catch my breath for just a moment. But it'll be easier next time. So
sounds good.
Okay.
Sounds good. So in case of a strong aftershock, were there plans for an evacuation in place? Hurry cover.
Actually they you know, they're so far from the hill. They said was if there was one, They strong aftershock. Well, not much else can fall down. They just said avoid the buildings, you know, stay in the open space. And as the high schools are still standing. And they said if there was a really strong one in their warning of a tsunami to run back up that hill. But that hill is pretty far from where we were. So there's not much you can do.
run fast.
Just go on top of the roof of your building. A lot of people actually did that. They lived because they went on the second floor of the roof of their houses and survived the tsunami.
Mm. Okay.
So, yeah, not much that they said, you know.
Mm. Okay. Okay, well, okay, cool. So, let's see.
Other questions? All right.
Any other questions, everyone? So, unless you guys have any other questions, I'm just going to move into next guest, next reporter of the show. Taka is coming up for...
Taka
is coming up. Shoot.
Okay, you know what? I'm gonna sign off, okay. But I'm gonna still listen. And if you need something from me, or if I have a question, I'll post it.
Yeah, sure. But all right.
But I'm definitely listening. But my voice is a little tired from yesterday. Barking at all the volunteers doing it. Poor guys. I was too abusive, I tell you. But anyway, we got things done. So anyway, thank you for talking about this. Thank you for putting it on your program.
No. I love to support people like you. And then eventually I want to go up there and see it, help
okay.
people too. So yeah, thank you very much, April. And then I also love to... help you on your charity concert then too. So we'll talk maybe once you got rested throughout
okay.
at the end of the week or something.
Oh, that'd be great.
All
that'd
right.
Be yeah. Thank
come
you
find
so
me.
Much.
What's all up? Right. Find me on Facebook.
Yeah.
Good. I will. I'll go and find you.
You can find me from the
there, I think.
From the pictures.
Okay.
There's a link to my name at the top of the album.
Oh, yeah. Terrific! Great, Jim.
I will send you I will reintroduce you guys anyway.
Oh, that's perfect.
Actually, it's really easy. Facebook.com/BORREN. Borden.
That is easy. And Jim, I just wanted to tell you one thing. Whoops, I'm supposed to call you Borden, not Jim, right?
It's
Borden.
Okay.
I just wanted to tell you one thing. I listened to you when you were on Kat's show, which, by the way, you can archive on Yokoso News.
Thank you for sharing.
Thank you for the plug.
Two weeks ago. I actually listened intentionally twice to hear what you said and look at the pictures. And I told Kat that helped me prepare myself and the group for what kind of environment we were walking into as far as location or how we were going to set up. I saw the parking lot you were in. I thought, okay, this is probably going to be our scenario also. So that helped me a lot. So thanks for sharing that.
I'm glad.
Okay, you two cuties, I'm signing off, but I'm still listening.
All right. It has been April Perkinson from Kanagawa. No, I'm sorry, Kawasaki, Kanagawa. She's the, what is your job now?
I'm a volunteer organizer.
But she is like doing the English job and then music. Oh, a promoter job, and then...
no, jazz stylist teacher.
A jazz stylist teacher, but you organize the concert now, so you're a kind of event promoter now.
Yeah, true. Good point. And I teach adults English.
You don't have a website?
Oh, not yet. Actually, I think it's now time I have to do one, but everybody knows how to find me. Facebook is like a website these days.
Yeah, maybe you should at least start the Facebook fan page of you.
Oh!
not
now I'm turning red.
because you know, fan page. You wanna separate your private Facebook profile and then
fan page.
Taka-san, Taka-san, 申し訳ないです。あの、ユーストリームの音声消していただけますか？
はい。
はい、OK です。Sorry, April.
No yeah. problem.
So you should at least start the Facebook fan page.
Okay.
Yeah, maybe I will help you out at least this as a thanks. Thank you for, you know, helping me out on the Yokosu News and stuff. So
okay. Yeah. All right. We'll help each other.
Yeah. Cats and Roses. Thank you, April. Great job.
Thank you.
And then Liz, April, thank you for what you did for them. And then, yeah, so Sakura, can you tell I watched JCB? Okay. And that's a different story. But,
yeah.
All right. Maybe I have to, next time we should do a curry.
Oh, April. Yeah, but you know what it has to be, right? Diet curry.
Diet curry.
Diet curry.
No. We talked about the before we were on the air. I told her about curry, and then she said she needs to find something that doesn't have lots of calorie.
So. Cats, I don't know how you said, well, that's another topic for your curry show. I'll hold that. Never mind.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
All right. Awesome job, April from Harry Kovier from Hawaii. Thank you very much. Cats and Roses from Germany. Thank you very much, April. Thank you. Thank you very much, April.
You're so welcome. I really enjoyed it. Bye, guys.
Bye.
I'll talk to you later in the week, Cats.
Okay. Bye.
And I'm going to be listening.
Okay. Thank you.
Bye.
Hello everyone, this is Katz from Yokosu News, yokosunews.com. Yokosu News is the online website to introduce Japan in English so that you can understand Japan more. You can like us at Yokosu News on Facebook or follow us at Yokosu News on Twitter. Our website is at yokosunews.com. We usually introduce the Japanese culture, entertainment information in English, but because of March 11th tsunami, earthquake, and Fukushima nuclear power plant incident, I've been kind of volunteering some of my time to let you know what is going on in Japan. Yokosu News is the one of our mission of Yokosu News is to provide information in English, but also in case of the emergency as well, because I was in the US during the 9/11 and other disaster, so I know how foreigners feel in the foreign country in case of the disaster. So I want Yokosu News to be function as the information source in case of the emergency. So this is the reason why I'm doing this disaster update. Today is the 36th day of the March 11th disaster update. We just had a guest from April. April Perkinson from Kawasaki, Kanagawa. She just went to North Japan, Miyagi, Ishinomaki to be exact, to volunteer, held the barbecue, giving away the toy gift and stuff. So she just shared with us how she did and then volunteer. That's hopefully that's going to encourage people to volunteer. Now we need volunteer. After the 2 months of the earthquake, there are still many places that devastated by the tsunami and earthquake, and we still need help. So I'm hoping people to continue provide the volunteer work. So I'm hoping to share this knowledge with you guys so that you have something that you could know. Ikara's question earlier about if some of the US wants to host the kids, school kids, that's actually a little bit difficult right now, but maybe Ikara's, you should send me an email at the yokosunews.com. Yeah. So if you have any question, if you're watching this archive, click go to yokosunews.com and click contact us hyperlink on the top right of the page, and then you can send us an email. as well. All right, now, Taka-san, yoroshii desu ka?
Hai, okay desu.
So now we have Taka, the videographer from iFeel, who is the organizer of iBreezeIwaki.net to report about what is going on from Iwaki, Fukushima. Iwaki, Fukushima is the 30 to 50 kilometers south of Fukushima, Japan. I mean, Fukushima nuclear power plant. So we now, Yokoso News now have an eye on Iwaki, Fukushima, and he's going to share us what happened a little bit in last weekend. Yeah, Taka-san, moichido. So Taka-san, would you introduce yourself again, please? Yeah, Taka-san, moichido, jiko shoukai o kantan ni onegai shimasu.
Hai, minasan konbanwa. Watashi wa Fukushima ken Iwaki shi de eizou seisaku no shigoto o shiteiru Takahagi to moushimasu.
Hi, hello everyone. My name is Takahagi. I call him Taka. I do a videography work in Iwaki, Fukushima. Hi, hi. Then Taka-san has this website. Taka-san just launched this website called iBreezeIwaki.net to report about what's going on in around the Iwaki. So, Taka-san, 今週, if you want to know about what is his experience of Iwaki, you can actually check the last week's archive of Yokoso News Disaster Update. まあ詳しいタカさんのね、福島の 個人的な経験は前の週のアーカイブを見てもらうということにして、今日はタカさん、So Taka san, so you have the update of this week or what happened last weekend in Fukushima. Taka san, yeah, 先週末なんいわきであったイベントを紹介 していただけるということで、何でしょうか。
はい、日曜日に、原発をはん、さよなら原発ということで、パレードがありました。
So last Sunday, 2 days ago, at the Iwaki, Fukushima, there was an anti-nuclear parade, demonstration rally in Iwaki, Fukushima. So he got a little bit of the archive for us. And then... Okay. じゃあちょっと再生しながら見ていきましょう。So, where was this takes place? じゃあこれどこでやってたんでしょうかね。
はい、これはいわき市の平にあります市役所の隣にある、芸術ホールの平中央公園ですね。
So this is the nearby the city hall of Iwaki, Fukushima. They at the park, the 公園市役所の近くの公園ってことですね。
そうですね。
So near the city hall. So first, what were they doing? 最初何されてたんですかこれ？
最初パレードに先立って1時間ぐらいですね。スピーカーの方がおいでになって、いろんなスピーチがありました。
So first, before the demonstration, they held some kind of speech, so spoke in front of the audience. So what did they mainly talk about? それでスピーカーの中にはどういう人がいてどういうことを話されてたんですか。
まずですね、このパレード集会を主催しました、いわき市アクションママの会。 の代表の方と、あとそれをこうバックアップ、東京から来てくださったバックアップしてくれる方、この人のお話、そして、市議会の議員さんですね、
うん、
はい、あと原発反対の推進をされている代表の方々、岡山県、大阪の方、あるいは東京の方からおいで、くださいました。
なるほど。So, these are the group of the people. Main organizer are the group of mothers. で、お母さんの団体ですね。
そうですね。
So, mainly the group of the volunteer of the mothers in Iwaki City, Fukushima organized this. And then,some of the organization, anti-nuclear organization, and then city council members, and then came to attend and speak out in front of the people. There were also the people from Tokyo, Tokyo to Fukuoka,
Okayama,
Okayama.
あと山口下関、
岡山、山口、下関、any like all over Japan。
はい、
はい、はい。So they then after the speech they went to rally these so yeah so that'sJa, Imad, so is this anti-nuclear rally thing is happening quite often in Iwaki now? こういうそのデモっていうのは今いわきではたくさんあるんですか？
これが初めてですね。
So this is the kind of the first time to held the kind of big.Large-scale anti-nuclear like demonstration happened in Iwaki, Fukushima. はいはい、なるほど。Thank you very much. So, how was it? What kind of people was attending this event, and how many people?どんなような人たちで、どれぐらいの人がいたと思われます？
ですね、まずどんな方かと言いますと、まずは、子供さんを持っている、お父さんお母さん、
うん、
そしてあとはですね、いわき市の方だけではなくて、近隣の郡山市あるいは福島市、
うん、
そういったところでやはりこう原発に対してこう不安を持っているとか、
うん、
そういった方が集まってきました。
So, mainly, first of all, this was organized by mothers and with young children. So, many mothers who has, you know, kids came on board.And then not only the Iwaki itself, but also surrounding city like Koryama. Yeah, so came to attend this event and stuff. Okay, so what was the vibe? How was the vibe there? その雰囲気というか。どんな感じだったでしょう。
そうですね、そんなにこう殺伐とした雰囲気ではなくて、
うん、
やはりあの趣旨がですね、
うん、
やはりその放射の汚染は危険だということをもっと深く理解してほしいということと、子どもに対する影響をもっと深刻に考えなければいけないので、もっと行政の方に子どもを守るための方向性をよくこう考えてほしいという趣旨が強く感じました。
So, you know, this demonstration looks much serious, not like, you know, but he was able to feel how urgent they want other people to know about the danger of the radiation.Also, how urgent to protect the young kid that they feel that they need to protect the kid from the radiation and stuff. Any question, Borden?
Well, maybe this is kind of a difficult question, but were they talking about any alternatives that they wanted?
Besides, in terms of the energy?
Yeah, instead of nuclear, is anti-nuclear rally, what did they want to replace it with?
例えば、まあこれ反原発じゃないですか。
そうですね。
例えば違うものは大会エネルギーはどうしたらいいとかそういう提案とかはなかったんですか？
このここではですね、その提案に提案というよりも、まずその現状の例えばその、測定値の基準値ですか、
はいはい、
基準値が、震災前よりも引き上げられてしまったりとか、そういうことでそのなんていうんですかね、健康被害が、もっと深刻であろうにもかかわらず、大丈夫なんだ安全なんだという、行政の情報発信に対して、そうではないでしょうと。あともう一つは、原発の運転を即やめるべきで、あってほしいという思いがですね、なかなか伝わっていないということですね。
So, it's not about the alternative. They didn't really talk about the alternative energy. It just because they it's now Japanese public don't really notice about how danger the radiation threat could be. So the organizer wanted to first of all spread the danger of the radiation. And also recently Japanese government raised the regulation, like allowance, radiation allowance level to the, from 100 millisievert to 200 millisievert and stuff. And also kids, they set the allowance of the radiation allowance of the kids to like 20 millisievert or something. So they first of all wanted to, the main purpose of that event was to try to spread the word to the Japanese public that that we have to take the radiation stuff seriously. So they didn't talk about the alternative energy, but I feel they should talk about it though. Yeah. まあでも大会エネルギーをなんとかしなきゃいけないっていうのはね、ちょっと考えないと、それも考えないといけないと思うんですけどねっていう。
そうですね。
うん、他には、is there anything else happen in Iwaki Fukushima over the weekend? 他には何かイベントとかありましたでしょうか？
そうですね。まあ最初にパレード前に、そういったこうスピーチがありまして。それが1時間、
うん、
であとの1時間が公園から、
うん、
JR のいわき駅前まで、
うん、
そうですね、距離にして約4キロぐらいかな、
うん、
4キロか5キロぐらいをパレードしたということなんですけども、うん、まあ、それ以外にはイベントとしてはなかったですね。
So the last weekend, so they didn't have notmuch other event, major event besides this demonstration. So first 1 hour they did the kind of the speech for 1 hour in front of the people. Then after that they did demonstration about 4 kilometers from the park to the station. So that was pretty much what happened last weekend. 他にもじゃあそんな感じですね。
あと感じたのは、
うん、
まずですね、共催、要は主催者が2つだったんですけども、うん、1つは地元いわきのアクションママクラブ、もう1つが、
うん、
東京に事務所があります、
うん、
ノーニュークスモアハーツっていうあの団体なんですね、
うん、
でそちらの団体が、まあ、強くバックアップしてくださいまして、
うん、
その理由というのは、
うん、
やはりその原発周辺地域の方が、
うん、
もっと声を上げなければ、
うん、
この悲惨な状況が、
うん、
広く世間に伝わらないと、
うん、
だからもっとその地域の方はもっとよりこう強く深刻に受け止めてもっともっと声を上げてほしいということを訴えてました。
なるほどね。 So organizer, what he was saying that this still the demonstration stuff for the Fukushima that they had two organizer, main organizer. One is from the Iwaki's mothers group.
Action Mama Club.
Action Mama Club. And then other one was from the organizer, the anti-nuclear organization from Tokyo.
No nukes, more hearts.
Yeah, no nukes, more hearts. And then they were saying that they wanted to the Fukushima residents to raise their voice in order to tell the people around Japan. So they were there to support, to raise the voice, try to assist to raise the voice of nuclear power plant situation and stuff. Okay. 他にこのデモ以外で何か気づいたこととかそういうのはないですかね。
そうですね、デモ以外で気づいたというかですね、
イベントというか、まあ、いわきの状態というか、
やはりいわきの状態として感じたのは、
うん、
いわきの人の参加するした人数が、
うん、
まあ多分思ったよりというかきっと少ない気がしましたね、う
ん、何人ぐらい。
ですね、いわきの人が何人か とかまでは把握できてないんですけども、うん、パレード自体の参加人数が、うん、主催者発表では約500名でした、
うん、So according to the organizer, there are about 500 people attend to the event, I think. So, yeah, that's much less than...
much less than he thought, right?
Yeah, much less than... much less than the one in Tokyo.
Ah.
I think. Two. I mean, that's my... I mean, from the previous event. Yeah. Okay. So, is there anything else? Is there anything else besides this demonstration? このデモ以外のことでなんかいわきでなんか なかったですかね。
デモ以外では、まあ、この日は主だったことはなかった、
まあ、この1週間でも何でも。
あ、そうですね、例えば、今朝なんですけども、うん、静岡の方から、
うん、
原発福島第一原発の、
うん、
汚染水、
はいはいはい、
汚染水を、一時備蓄といいますか、
うん、
保管するための、メガフロートという人工の、
はいはい、
それが、今日小名浜港に到着したということで、
うん、
Ah, that's right. That was Iwaki.
Yeah. So, a mega float from Shizuoka to store all the
wastewater
has arrived.
Or contaminated water.
Yeah, so that's, I think, the update of today, earlier, I think. And then, yeah. Yeah. Okay, cool.じゃあまあそんな感じでですね。そしたら今週は
そうですね、はい、まあさっきのちょっとパレードに付随してしまうんですけども、
うん、
じゃあどうしてパレードデモの参加者が少ないのか、
うん、
というところに引っかかるの、多分関連してるのかなと思うのは、
うん、
いわきからも、
うん、
やはりその東電原発にですね、うん、 関連するこう仕事についてる方って結構いらっしゃるんですね。なものですから、本来、一番ご被害を受けている近隣地域が声を高くしてデモをしなきゃいけないところだと思うんですが、実はそこに、仕事として関連性のある、あるいは従事していた方が多いので、簡単にその大きい、まあ、声高らかに、ノーニュークスということで、高まらないのかなという思いもありますね。
So he was saying that the reason why this May 15thIwaki's anti-nuclear demonstration didn't have much people. It's because in Iwaki, Fukushima, there are many people who actually work for TEPCO and who works for this nuclear power plant. Because many people were benefiting from this nuclear power plant, so that's maybe the one of the reason why there are not so much people joining the anti-nuclear demonstration.
That's kind of a lose-lose situation for them.
Yeah. Yep. Okay. So that's pretty.街店、いや、そんな感じですね。
そうですね、まあ、あとあれですね、一つこう残念なニュースだったのは、メルトダウンしてたのは実は震災直後からだったという発表があったんですね。まあ、それはもう皆さんニュース等々でも把握されてると思うんですけども、まあ、それは非常にこう、ああ、そういうことだったのかということで、残念でしたね。
So, one thing that he wanted to add that, regarding the news of the meltdown, so, he also heard the news that the meltdown occurred within a day since the earthquake. So, he was, Taka-san himself also feel disappointed.About the news, then それはなんででしょうか。
なんででしょうか。
分かってるんですけど、なんで残念だったんでしょうか。
あ、要はですね、タイムリーに、真実が。連絡といいますか、発表といいますか、発表されない、そういうことが残念でしたね。
So, what he's disappointed about this meltdown news is that the information wasn't disclosed in timely manner.
Or it wasn't known in a timely manner.
What do you mean? It wasn't known in
the reason. I think the reason that they're able to report that now is because, you know, the people got inside the building and put in the new measuring equipment.
Yeah, many experts were already saying, including all other media.
I could say anything I want about it. I could say that it's melted into the ground, but you know, unless they have proof, they probably don't want to say it.
Yeah. まあ、まあ、ジムと僕が話してたのは、まあね、専門家は、だ僕は専門家はもうずっと言われてたやんかって言ってたんやけど、まあでも、まあ、やっとこさ、ケーキが入れられたんが数日前やから、まあ、確信する前に時間かかったのかなっていうのもありますよねっていうことですね。だけども専門家も、直後からメルトダウンしてるんじゃないかっていうことはずっと言われてたわけで、両方のサイドの、批判がありますよねっていう。でそれでまあもちろんそんなにお話はされたかどうかわからないですけども、どうです、反応は。そういうこと話されました。
いや、それに関しては特にあれですね、後の祭り的な感じですよね。
うん、そうですよね。
え、
うん。Oh, I just asked him, if he has talked to anyone about that issue, and he hasn't yet. And it sounds like, atodashi janken. It's like, well, how do you say? Atonomatsuri.
Atodashi janken?
Yeah,
it sounds like.
It's like, the late, you know, they kind of waited to disclose the information. It sounds like they waited to disclose the information on purpose. Yeah, so.
Who knows?
はい、じゃあ、そんな感じでタカさん。
はい。
ありがとうございました。
どうもありがとうございました。
So, everyone, it has been the live report from Taka, videographer work from the iFields production in Iwaki, Fukushima.He had been reporting live weekly what's going on in Iwaki, Fukushima. He's located 40 kilometers south of the southwest of Fukushima nuclear power plant, and he's been reporting that. And he has the Japanese website called iBreeze Iwaki, i-breeze-iwaki.net.And I'm also assisting him to kind of try to make the website going too. And then he's sparing his time to report what's going on, the situation of Fukushima from it too. All right. Thank you very much, Taka-san. Yeah, Taka-san, どうもありがとうございました。
ありがとうございました。
はい。
So, everyone, now...Let's move on to the weekly update of the Fukushima nuclear power plant. Everyone, this is Katz from Yokoso News, yokosonews.com. Yokoso News is the online website to introduce Japan in English so that you can understand Japan more. Yokoso News is usually the online website to introduce Japanese culture. April, you forgot to tell me the name of your event. Yes, April, tell me. You wanna talk? You wanna come back on Skype to talk to me about it? So tell me about it. So Yokoso News is the online website to introduce Japanese culture in English. So, for example, you can check like show like Dr. Shinsaku. I'm so in love with Dr. Shinsaku.
How do you know Dr. Shinsaku?
I know his assistant, doctor's assistant, which is his dad. So Dr. Shinsaku, you can check out the archive and demand for the replay. So
the next episode.
I think second or third week of June.
Yes.
Yeah. So
yes.
Sunday. But I think I need to bribe him. I think I need
to. Well, you know his favorite snack.
Yeah, I know. And then I know, I think I need to buy him some mini car or something.
Mini car.
So I think I need to coordinate. I need some help. I think I need some donation concepts for Dr. Shinsaku. And then I just did the Japanese curry brainwashing. So you can check the archive. And then I lost. So...
I want to be a judge.
You should come.
I might come to the next one.
Yeah. Or we could organize it. And then, again, next emergency broadcast, Disaster 311 Disaster Update is coming up next Tuesday, 8 p.m. Just a regular update. I don't know. I don't have anyone to speak yet.To talk about the guest, but so music for the charity. April, the name is Music for Charity. That's the name?
That's what it looks like.
That's the name of the event? April?
She said, simple, ne?
Okay. So April is going to have a music for the charity event. She just spoke to me. You will be able to watch the archive once I finish this show. And then, yeah. So, okay. So now, let's do, so we usually do the fun stuff about Japan, but since March 11th, the earthquake, I've been decided to provide you the latest information of what's going on in North Japan and the Fukushima nuclear power plant situation, because I was in the US during the 9/11 and other disaster, and I know how you would feel like as a foreigner in Japan without certain information. If you couldn't speak Japanese, then you might suffer from the information, lack of the information. So Yokoso News is, you know, has the dedicate to the people who live in Japan, don't really speak English. That's the first priority that I like this broadcast dedicated to. And the second people I like this broadcast dedicated to is the people who have a direct relationship to Japan and the people who still want to know what's going on in Japan. So, music for charity. Okay. April, I think can I say, Jim? Can I say something, Jim? What do you think about the name of the music for the charity? Music for charity.
I don't know. It's the content is more important to me.
Okay, good. Yeah, but naming is also kind of important to me too.
Well, do you have another suggestion?
Like, have a curry charity concert.
You're inserting your agenda into her concert.
Oops. No. All right. All right. Anyway, let's get back to the serious topic. So this is the update between April 11th to April 17th. The quick update of what's going on in Japan. Again, I'm just reading off what the Japanese mainstream media, what the Japanese government are saying. So, You should believe what the Japanese government said as much as you believe your own government. You should believe what the mainstream media say as much as you believe your own mainstream media says. April, thank you for on the Skype text message. Thank you. yes. So last week, May 11th, it's been 2 months since the disaster happened. So we now in the construction mode for the North Japan area. But we have couple main concern right now is the how we can finish building the temporary housing so that people finally can live with the privacy. And then second is how we take care of the debris, which someone mentioned. What's up, eyes? And then Botoids. Yes, Botoids said 11 minutes ago. What's up, Botoids? So Japanese government, according to NHK and other sources, Japanese government asked 30 prefecture, all the prefecture except Okinawa, to accept the debris from North Japan, not the radiation one, but the debris from the North Japan to recycle, to help accept those debris. But, in the 30 prefectures out of 46 say that they would accept. But you know, how it's amazing number of the debris it's coming up. So it's much, much more than the Great Hanshin earthquake 15 years ago. So that's the concern about the debris, how to take care of the debris. And the third concern is the economy of North Japan. So many people are still unemployed, and then I heard that people in the food stamp, Seikatsuhogo, it's called Seikatsuhogo, the food stamp has it's about to exceed 2 million people. So according to Yomiuri on May 12th, and then that's so Ministry of Health said on May 12th that at the end of the February, people on the food stamp Seikatsuhogo were about 1.98 million people. So this is the number from the end of the February. So that this is before the earthquake. So it looks like more people are going to in North Japan and stuff. And when what else? Actually, sorry everyone, I was concentrating on April and disaster after earlier guests and stuff, so I wasn't really getting ready to collect the weekly update. And then,
well, of course the big story is the mega float.
Oh, mega flow. I mean, that's no big story. No, I'm talking about the North Japan earthquake information first.
Oh.
So then going to that's about the tsunami and earthquake situation of Japan. And now next going to the nuclear power plant. Update from in between May 11th to May 17th. So May 14th, last Saturday, one of the TEPCO's contract workers died on site of the Fukushima nuclear power plant. So what happened was he was in the 60s, and then he was working for the heavy machinery, and then he suddenly started feeling sick and he lost conscious, and he was sent to the hospital and he passed away. And that was in the morning of May 14th, like 9 o'clock. He passed away at 9 a.m. on May 14th. And then he wasn't really exposed to the radiation. It's about below 1 millisievert, like 0.7 millisievert of the exposure to the radiation. So it didn't look like the cause of his death was from the radiation, but heart attack. So, and heart attack is caused by the heavy stress and stuff. Then, as you know, the workers on site of Fukushima nuclear power plant are wearing those protective suits to avoid the radiation exposure. And right now they're wearing double. Some of them are wearing double protective suits. So then they wear masks. So what happened according to NHK and Nihon TV's report. They cannot pretty much breathe. They cannot like even swipe their sweat. So because they wear the protective suits all around and it's getting hotter and hotter. So the working environment, you know, it's easy to get the heat fever. So that's the yeah. So both toys, yes, was the worker tested for the cause of death? Yes. It's shinkin kousoku. What's shinkin kousoku? Shinkin kousoku.
I thought it was a heart attack.
Yeah, it's kind of heart diseases. Shinkin kousoku.
Shinkin kousoku.
What? My Japanese translation doesn't work.
Myocardial infarction. Yeah, heart attack.
Yeah. Okay, heart attack. Okay, good. So, yeah, that's for now, after the autopsy. So, yeah, April. Yeah, he was tested, but this is what they were talking about 3 weeks ago, and this thing would happen. Yeah, so that's, yeah. Then, next major news of the, next major news of the Fukushima nuclear power plant is meltdown. So on the May 14th, when was it? When did they admit the meltdown? First,
it was in the last couple of days.
Oh, the May, yes, May 13th.
Oh.
May 13th, typical, first use the, May 12th, I'm sorry, May 12th, typical, first admit the, typical first admit the possibility of the meltdown on the first nuclear reactor, according to NHK, Yomiuri, Nihon TV, TV Tokyo, all the news sources that I've been watching. So last week, they were able to send the worker into the first nuclear reactor. Then they were finally able to fix the. fix. Are they allow the women back to, into the plant work, both toys? As far as I know, no. Because of high amount of radiation. No more women are allowed to work in the Fukushima nuclear power plant because they could be pregnant. And then it's not good for pregnant women to be exposed to more than 5 millisieverts of radiation in 3 months.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the reason why TEPCO are not letting women to work on the site of the nuclear power plant. That's the government regulation as well. So on the last week, between like May 9th to May 11th and stuff, they tested the radiation level and they tried to clean up the air of the inside of the first nuclear reactor's buildings so that worker can finally go in there and work. So they did. They first went into the reactor building. Then what they found, then they were finally able to fix the water level sensor of the reactor. Then once they were able to fix the water level sensor of the reactor, then they realized that there's no water at all at the level of the fuel rod were supposed to be. So it is obvious that the fuel rod has been melted down. And then, however, they didn't notice any re-criticality, like they haven't reached the re-critical point yet. So they are suspecting that still there are some water at the bottom of the reactor. And so they were able to continue cooling down the fuel rod with those water that they kept pumping. They start pumping in 16 hours after, 17 hours after the earthquake, that they resume pumping into the reactor. But they think that they would be leak. There would be a hole in the Fukushima reactor. So those hole dropped some part of the fuel rod into the reactor containment, and then so the reactor container may also be full of those
corium.
So,
and also since there's a hole there, the water goes out the hole too.
Yeah, that then, well, there's also, there may be also hole in the reactor container too, so, or some leakage of the water too. So actually I'm trying to pull up the press photo of,
and since, well, this new information that the containment might have cracked, most nuclear safety standards are based on the fact that the containment will never fail.
Yeah.
So the now plan. That it has failed, possibly they're gonna have to, you know, look at that again.
Yeah. So they now have to revise on the
safety.
Not safety. I mean the plan. 6 months plan that they were
planning. Oh yeah, that too.
Yeah.
But
so
in long term.
Yeah. So. So they will have to. So I have a picture from TEPCO website that what they've been working on. So worker has finally been. So this is the picture of the worker released by TEPCO that they were fixing the water level inside of the nuclear reactor, and then this is when they found out, oh, there's no water in the reactor.
Still no black suits.
Yeah.
From Florida.
I don't know.
I'm really waiting for those.
Okay. Then I have the picture of mega float arrive in Fukushima here. So mega float, they're gonna use this float, which has a huge tank, to store the contaminated water there. So yeah, they are going to have a revise a lot of things. Yes. So so I think it's by tomorrow they are going to release the revised plan. Oh no. So today they released the revised plan. So then sorry. So last May 12th, they admit the possibility of the meltdown of the first reactor. So they were trying to water seal the reactor container to continue cooling down the reactor, but it's not, we can't do it because there's a hole in the both nuclear reactor and then reactor containment. So they need to have to cancel the water seal plan, and they are now switching to water circulation plan to continue cooling plan. And then, so today, May 17th, TEPCO released the revised plan of the their 9 months plan. So they are going, yeah, that's pretty much they're going to do. They just cancel the plan to do the kansui. I don't know in English, but water seal plan, and then they're gonna switch to water circulation cooling plan or something. So that's what they plan to do.
Kansui.
Mm.
It like Niwaki ni kansui suru.
Flood. Yeah, flooding. Like.
Oh, that kansui.
Yeah,
there's
flooding.
Lots of kansuis. There's five of them.
Yeah, I know. Flooding one.
Yes.
So yeah, Tuesday today, Liz. Yeah, but some people may be watching archive, so I have to make sure I set the date for the people who might be watching this video at the archive. So, where is the leaking water currently going, Botoi? So first nuclear reactor, they found lots of amount of water underground of nuclear reactors building. So they already found a highly contaminated water on the underground of the first nuclear reactors building. So they didn't say anything. Yeah, they didn't say anything, but NHK said TEPCO didn't say anything, but NHK said that there is a possibility of those contaminated water underground of the first nuclear reactor could be leaking into the ocean, or they need to take some action to prevent from the leaking onto the ocean.
Didn't they start pumping from a new reactor?
Yeah, that's the third nuclear reactor. So they start pump. Chasing after the rabbit or something. You know, they found one reactor's the trench tunnels. They see the rise of the water levels, so they need to start pumping that one more than other one too. So now in a way, the situation of the Fukushima nuclear power plant is getting stabler, but still high amount of the radiation are detected in especially the west side of the Fukushima nuclear power plant, for example, Itate village and stuff. And then so we have a concern towards the kids and mothers. So a couple, I think 2 days ago, May 15th or May 14th, the mothers and kids of Itate village start evacuating outside of Itate village. So that was also in the news. And then third nuclear reactors start nuclear reactors, turbine buildings underground. They start moving the water today, according to typical 5 p.m. typical press conference on May 17th. The water contaminated radioactive contaminated water underground of the third reactor's turbine building, the water level start rising. So they are going to transport the water onto the onto those central disposing processing facility nearby, which is about 10 to 12 tons per hour. They TEPCO said they think they have about 22,000 tons of the radio contaminated water underground, at the underground of the turbine building of the third reactor. So Jim, Borto is
Yeah, hold on, I'm getting it.
Okay. I didn't hear about anything about that news, so I need you to find out.
Okay.
So but then according to a Japanese government, they said that they are going to give a special allowance to the self-defense personnel who's working in and around Fukushima nuclear power plant. So yeah. So okay. Then what else? And another news about North Japan, the number of the volunteer in Tohoku area declined significantly. So yeah, after the Golden Week, so they need more volunteer now. And
well, hopefully I'll be back there again someday.
Yeah. Well, we should do on the weekend, you know. And then so that's and then people start evacuating, and then people actually on the week towards the this week, residents of the 20 kilometers radius of the Fukushima nuclear power plant were able to go back to their house for 2 hours to retrieve their belongings. Many of them went to pick up like wallet, bank checks, a photo album and stuff. Not so much big, of course, they cannot really retrieve the big stuff. So many residents of the Fukushima residents were able to go back to the to their houses, and some of the city officials were able to rescue some of the pets, dogs, and some of the pets were able to reunite with the owners when they went back to the town. And has the surrounding water levels. Oh, yes. So next, Ministry of Education, who is supervising to measure the ocean level, surrounding ocean level, they increase the number of the sampling point of the sampling point too. So we are now be able to get more in-depth radioactive contamination surrounding city. If you go to mixed.go.jp, I think. Yeah, mixed.go.jp, you will be able to get the radioactive information of ocean surrounded by sea, reading of sea otter radio. I have it on the I have the reading of May 8th reading. Not detected and stuff. Yeah, so if you go to max.go.jp, you could get those data of the sea water's radioactive contamination stuff as well. Yeah, and Moody's lowered the rank of the TEPCO 2 steps from BWA1 to BWA3. So they are not worth investing. So, hey Liana, hi to the Malaysia. So, that's pretty much it of update of the TEPCO. Main update of this week is that TEPCO finally able to confirm the possibility of the meltdown, and almost they did meltdown, but no one is able to visually check inside of the reactor yet. But from the reading, they were finally able to fix the water level sensor of the first reactor, and then because they were able to fix it, and then they were able to confirm the meltdown, and then
there was another part of that story that I saw where they said that the cooling system was manually shut down.
Oh yeah, that's the one of the news that I,
for some reason.
Yeah, so that's actually it's today's news. It's they TEPCO finally disclosing the memo of log of the workers the day of the earthquake. Then however, it's just a memorandum, so we'll know more by next week. So both toys has the death toll increased. Okay, so I have a death toll. According to police department of May 17th. So, $15,093 total death toll. And then the number of missing has gone down. 9,093 people are missing. So less than 10,000 now.
Still an unbelievably high number.
Yeah, but it used to be over 10,000. But now less than 10,000 people are missing as we were able to find more bodies and stuff. So the total number of deaths and missing are now 24,186.
I have a newspaper from the day after the earthquake. Guess what the death toll is on the newspaper?
100?
20.
Oh, yeah. Well, of course, I knew it because the when the Hanshin Kobe earthquake happened in 95, you know, it was like that. I remember the news was saying like 7 people die on the second, you know, first day of the earthquake. Then I see the number goes up within a week. So
yeah, well, this is my first time, so I was suckered.
Okay. Yeah. Yep. But I kinda knew. I mean, when I watch back my archive, I did mention that it could be around or maybe a little bit less than Hanshin earthquake. So on the first day, I was kind of saying that it could be death toll could be go up to 5,000 or, you know, something like that. But so Liana, you were in Yokohama, Japan when 9.0 first hit, first time. Oh my god, you experiencing the earthquake for the first time? Okay.
It wasn't my first earthquake, but it was my first big earthquake.
Yeah. Well, next one is coming up in Tokai earthquake.
Yeah, in the next 30 years, right?
Yeah, next 30 years, 87% chance.
Ugh.
So, I think boarding Saitama, it's going to be okay.
But I'm moving to Tokyo next month.
Oh, really? Oh, you got the job?
I did get a new job.
Oh, congratulations, Borden.
Oh, thank you.
Maybe you should come to Yokkaichi.
Someday, and well, when's your next curry eating competition?
Okay, so that's pretty much this week's update, because I apologize, folks. I was concentrating on this volunteer effort, then still keep talking to Taka-san from Iwaki to coordinate.
Yeah, but that's way cooler anyway.
Okay, thank you.
Almost every story that you said was also reported on NHK World
in
English.
Yeah. So people, this week, next week, please go check NHK World, Kyodo English. They report those stuff anyway. And now Yokoso News disaster update. Now it's no longer emergency update. It's no longer, I think, it's still emergency, but it's kind of no longer emergency. So I think you can wait for a couple hours to hear the news. So Yokoso News rather want to concentrate on the first-handed news of the people out there. So Yokoso News is going to focus on those kind of first-handed news. So Liana, looking forward for the next curry competition. Thank you.
Yeah, this year my boss gave me a paper that has a bunch of useful websites, and there's 9 different English news sources written on it for Japan.
what's Japan? So Japan Today.
Japan Today.
news Kyoto, on Kyoto English.
Actually, and... Kyoto's not on here.
Oh, really?
Oh. Yeah. Okay. NHK World, Japan NHK Today, World. News on Japan, Daily Yomiuri, Japan Times, Asahi Shimbun, Mainichi Shimbun, and Saitama
Shimbun. Oh, you know, Asahi Shimbun, they went under.
Yeah, actually, yeah, I saw that.
Yeah, so one less news source. So, boat toys, an update from the US. We have a shortage of new Japanese car due to that disaster. And then, Cats and Roses. Okay, bye-bye. Thank you for watching. Yes, not only the Japanese car, I think some of the factory of the Chrysler in the US had to have an early summer vacation because of the shortage of the parts for the Chrysler. I think they need to have like a June summer vacation. Because of the shortage of the parts at the Chrysler, some of the Chrysler factory, according to Nikkei, the news that I read a couple of days ago. So, all right. So that's pretty much the update of this week's Japan. Apologize for I wasn't able to provide in-depth report of the all the news, but I wanted to share with you with the April Perkinson, who lives in Kawasaki, Kanagawa. She just went to Ishinomaki, Miyagi, to help the barbecue volunteer yesterday. So she shared a great experience of how she organized the group and how she went up there, how she was able to contact with the local people and how she drove up there and everything. So you can check the earlier archive when you're watching live, and then I will come back next. So again, Yokos News. If you have a question now, you can ask me. So Yokos News is, usually provide the fun stuff about Japan. For example, you can check Dr. Shinsaku, it's in the archive. You can also check Japanese Curry Brainwashing, that's on the archive of yokosunews.com. And then next Yokosunews weekly livecast is again this weekly disaster update coming up May 24th on Tuesday. So I have not planned for any other regular update of Yokoso News stuff. I have one new article coming up tomorrow with Sarah, but that's pretty much it. All right, anything else, Borden?
No.
Okay, congratulations on your job.
Oh, thank you. I hope that I can start it soon. The visa is going to take a little while, though.
Okay. Where are you moving to?
I'm moving to Adachi City.
Adachi-ku?
Yeah. Well, they call it Adachi City in English.
Oh, okay.
The official English name, Adachi-ku, Adachi City.
Oh, really?
Just for people who can't say Adachi-ku for some reason. The very, very, very like northern tip of it. Like,
yeah,
I ride
but
one
I,
train...
actually, I have a friend who does the hair salon there.
Ooh.
So, she can speak English.
Cool.
So, if you need some, and then she takes the, she charged by the dollar. Exchange. She actually calculate by the exchange rate, but she said she's getting tired, so she thinks that she might change it back to yen system. But
well, my friend got a new boyfriend who apparently cuts hair for celebrities.
Oh, okay.
So she says, "Oh, Jim, grow your hair so you can let him cut it." Okay, sure, why not? As long as I don't have to pay like 10,000 yen.
All right. Oh, April, thank you. Thank you for thank you for coming on Yokozo News. And then I love to support any effort like you. And if you have any suggestion about the volunteering stuff, I actually want to call, I want to encourage people to volunteer more in North Japan. So I'm going to try to organize more of those. Guys, you're welcome. Thank you for watching. Okay, so, all right. Any question, everyone? Otherwise, I am going to take off soon now. So
soon now.
Yeah.
Which is kind of like now.
Yeah. All right, everyone. So it has been the March 11th disaster update number 36. Oh my God, it's been 36 times. So you're...
Just a heartbeat away. April says, Jim is such just a heartbeat away from me. Well, if I'm a heartbeat away now, then after I move, I'll be half a heartbeat away.
Yeah, let's talk more about that. Okay, yeah. All right, everyone. So this has been the weekly March 11th disaster update of the Yokozo News. Yokozo News is the online website to introduce Japanese culture in English. In addition to fun stuff about Japan, I also want to share in case of the disaster and, you know, and then I really think that, you know, I mean, of course, no one wants to experience the disaster. But once you kind of experience it, you kind of can learn from it. And then I, you know, as I study our how we overcome the past disaster, you know, we learn so much. For example, we learn how to organize the volunteer, how we can coordinate the volunteer, and how we kind of need the organization little bit, but we don't really, we kind of have a basic, like, basic rules of the volunteering. But once you follow those rules, then the rest just go. Don't think about anything else. Just go. Just help, you know, help out the people. So we actually form the spirit of the volunteer through this disaster in the past past dozens of years too. So I really, you know, this is the spirit that we it's worth sharing to the rest of the world. So not only the fun part of the Japan, I really want to spread that how we overcome this disaster, what kind of problem we faced. Then as we share it, and we could you guys could take it as your knowledge. So that's I really want to do with the Yokozo News. So okay, it doesn't look like no one is having any questions. So Borden, so quick talk about today. What did you think about today?
What did I think about?
Yeah.
In terms of the news?
Yeah, I mean, and April's experience and then Taka's report.
When I heard April's, I saw April's, there are so many similarities between our trips, except, you know, hers was more successful than mine. That's what I kept thinking, like, oh man, why wasn't mine so successful? Why didn't I feed 200 people? Oh.
Well, no, it's good that so that you learn from I don't want to say that was your mistake. I think your friend has been going there every week.
Yeah, my friend, well, my friend's friend's friend, who is now my friend, sort of.
So, I'm sure if you keep going there regularly, then sometime you have a slow day, sometime you have a big day, especially during the Golden Week.
Yeah.
Many people are helping, so that's probably why you have less people. But now, less people are helping North Japan, I'm sure people are there too. Oh, April. Thank you. Yeah. I have help from Yamagata. I think yep. I need to... I think...
And I know at least two more people who want to go with me next time I go to volunteer.
Cool. So let's do something, man. Let's do something. Really soon, I hope. But this is the part of my volunteer too. By this is I'm doing what I can do for what I know I can do the best. By you know doing the social media thingy to spread the news and share the experience of the people in North Japan, so that by sometimes translating the information, and also try to connect in between the non-Japanese people and Japanese people. So that's the purpose of the stuff. Does Iwaki Glass Company has anything to the place Iwaki? That's too particular question.
Iwaki Glass Company.
I don't know. That's too particular.
Iwaki Glass Company.
Yeah, I don't.
It looks like they're not in Japan at all. It looks like they're in Thailand.
Okay. Okay. Well,
there's another one in Malaysia.
Okay. Well, I'm sure it's it sounds
and in what? I guess that's a pretty common name.
I don't know.
Japan.
Yeah, I haven't heard of that company name.
No. Iwaki Glass Shoko YK in Iwaki, Fukushima. That's a question for Taka.
Yeah, maybe. AGC. Oh, now it's Asahi Glass. Iwaki Glass is now Asahi Glass, I think.
I saw that too.
Yeah. They merged. Okay, in 1998. So.
Come and we'll feed at least 400. Yeah.
Yeah, April, I know, April. We'll talk more the detail. And also, I also want to support your concert and stuff, too. All right, everyone?
Music for Charity.
Yeah, Music for Charity concert. So, everyone, this is Katz from Yokosu News, yokosunews.com. If you are around Tokai area, Nagoya area, there is a walkathon charity event happening at the Morikoro Park in Nagakute, Aichi, Japan, where the expo used to be held. And then walkathon is like walk marathon charity. They do it. This is the 20th anniversary that they do, organized by American Chamber of Commerce of Japan. And yeah, so I might go there to check them out. So, all right, everyone. So now on Skype we have a Jim Borden on Skype. Hey. Thank you very much, Jim. Always.
Oh, I no love problem.
You. I love you.
I love hearing my voice all over the internet. And so does my mother.
Okay. All right. So everyone, next show is on the... I haven't planned anything on the weekend because I'm planning to go to Wakasan. But next live cast is on... The Tuesday on the April 24th. No, May 24th, Tuesday night, Japan Standard Time. All right. Thank you very much, everyone. Thank you, Jim. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Thank you.